20, the kickoff for the CIF 2A championship, taken by Chula Vista's number 40, Keith Krim, and he runs it out to the 36-yard line. Got a bit of a late start, but we'll have the entire game for you tonight. From San Diego, Jack Murphy Stadium, this is the CIF 2A championship game on Southwestern Cable TV. I'm Phil Urbina, along with Kevin Brass, bringing you tonight's game between the Chula Vista Spartans and the El Camino Wildcats. First and 10 for Chula Vista at the 39-yard line of El Camino. Pudgill, the quarterback, keeps it, looking for somebody to throw to under pressure, puts it up, and it's picked, nearly picked off. A great job by Ernie Spears. Tipped it up in the air and tried to come down with it. Couldn't quite do it. It'll be second and 10. Chula Vista brings an 11-1 record into this ball game. El Camino, 9-3.
Chula Vista's only loss came at the hands of the 3A powerhouse Sweetwater, who will be playing for the CIF 3A championship directly following this game. Again, we also will be covering, they'll be playing Mira Mesa.
Second down and 10 for Chula Vista. And they give it to the second man through, and he stopped immediately.
Right there was Tim Bush and some of his buddies from the interior of that El Camino defensive line. Very active defense for El Camino. They have been really on a roll. They've won 8 of its last 9 games. That's the Wildcats. And after a slow start, they've really come together. They were co-champions last year, but they've only got 2 returning starters from that team. So you only can take that into so much account. And what's really interesting is that we have 2 very young teams on there, especially with the Wildcats. A lot of juniors out there this year.
Sean Pocklington on that last carry, the tailback. He's normally the fullback, but we had some injuries last week. Pudgill running under some pressure, puts it up in the air, incomplete. And Chula Vista will be forced to punt. A good defensive series for El Camino. It did not give up a yard.
We should mention those injuries that you brought up, because that's, of course, because of Crash Frito Dwyer and his wrecking crew. Dwyer, the starting running back, was in a car accident right before the semifinal game, along with Ben Denken and J.J. Liggins. They should be able to see action tonight, though, and that's good news.
Well, Danken is definitely out. On the punt here, taken at the 40-yard line. Fair catch by El Camino. Matt Esposito doing the fair catch there. And now we'll see the El Camino offense.
And we will be seeing one of the most exciting running backs in the county right now. Only a junior, number 33, Darren Norris, CIF sprint champion. He was 5th in the state last year in the 100-meter dash. He's just a good all-around athlete. And it's a chance to see one of the best athletes in the county right here.
Ken Johnson at quarterback, Steve Miro at the fullback. Norris goes in motion. And they look downfield, and it's complete near the 50-yard line to number 8, Gerald Demery for El Camino.
Interesting, both teams open with a pass. That's just, I'm sure they're trying to take advantage of a little bit of the big game jitters and try to surprise the defenses, keep them off guard. Johnson, an improving quarterback. That was a good throw.
Second down and 1 for the Wildcats. Esposito goes in motion. They give it to Norris. Norris hit immediately, and he stopped for no gain on the play. It'll be third down and 1 for the Wildcats, who in their opening playoff game beats Southwest 17-7 and Crawford 16-6 in the semifinals.
And if you want to look at common opponents also, as we'll do it after this key third down play.
Norris at tailback, Miro at fullback. Third and 1, Esposito goes in motion. They give it to Miro. Miro over the left side, spins off a man, and appears to have the first down. Indeed, it is a first and 10 for the Wildcats.
Hey, Casey!
If you look at the common opponents, they have 4 of them: San Pasquale, San Marcos, Point Loma, and Southwest. As we look at the starting lineup for El Camino, those are the offensive line and some of their alternates. Casey Malululu, the big kid in there, he's a returning starter.
He and
Norris were the returning starters from last year's co-championship team.
Esposito in motion. They give it to Miro, right side, and not much there. Perhaps a couple of yards at best. Also mentioned Tim Bush on that offensive line, number 54, a first-team All-League selection.
To finish my point about the common opponents, the only difference was Point Loma beat El Camino, Chula Vista shut out Point Loma. Other than that, they were pretty consistent. I don't know if that tells you anything or not, but I thought I'd bring it up, you know, show I did my homework, be real impressive.
Chula Vista, the number one seed coming into the playoffs. El Camino, the number three seed. Chula Vista, number one throughout the year. And it'll be Norris trying to get outside. Still trying to get outside. Now he's got some room and gets up to the 45-yard line. Penalty flags go down.
Well, that's what speed will do for you. The play was designed to go inside. Norris just popped it out. But it appears the preliminary signal says it's going to go against El Camino. And you see the call. It's going to be 15 yards marched off against the Wildcats. Herb Meyer's not real happy about it. Herb Meyer, one of the winningest coaches in the county. What's his record these days? He's up there. He's 25 years in the county. His record is somewhere in the area of 125 wins to his credit. You look at a little bit more of the smiling faces of the Wildcats. These are the receivers. Esposito, the man to really watch for there.
Demery, Vidal, and Hughes also.
Second. There's Meyer's record. It's 121, 48, and 6. Not bad for Herb Meyer in his career at El Camino and at Oceanside. A couple CIF championships to his credit already.
Second and 32. Johnson to pass. Under some pressure. Now he's going to keep it. And he'll pick up some of the lost yardage, but he'll be well short of the first down.
Well, that's what Johnson can do so well. He's passed about 90 times during the season, but he can improv so very well. He's rushed more than 400 yards on the season, and he gives them that extra dimension. He'll still bring up a third and very, very long situation. And finishing off the starting lineup for El Camino, we see the smiling faces of the backfield. Steve Miro, an all-league defensive player. Number five also.
Johnson and Norris. Third down and long. They give it to Norris, and Norris stopped after a couple of yards gained. And El Camino now will be forced to punt.
And it's their first series was indicative of what's been their problem all season long. They've been averaging about 8 yards, 8 penalties a game. And that's what's been hurting them all year, turnovers and penalties. That is the Wildcats. And they really can't afford to do that against a Chula Vista team that loves to prey on those type of mistakes.
Fourth down, 13 to go. A high snap could be trouble. And nearly blocked. In fact, somebody got a piece of it. And it'll be down at the 44-yard line after J.J. Liggins, the man who was involved in that accident last week, got a piece of it after the high snap.
It was a heads-up play by Liggins because he saw the high snap and realized that he had a shot at it and just got enough of it to give the Spartans good field position.
Now we get a look at the El Camino defense, including linebackers Miro, number 5, and Bush, number 54.
Defense!
First and 10. Punt goal goes across the middle, and it's nearly intercepted. Ernie Spears nearly got his 8th interception of the year. He's come close to 2 of them. The pass intended for number 88, Darnell Woods.
Well, we haven't mentioned Woods yet, and we should, because Chula Vista loves to find ways to get Darnell Woods the ball. Once again, he is a junior also. A lot of good juniors on this field. And also, it's very interesting, both times on first down, Chula Vista's gone to the air.
Second and 10. Punt goal back to the air again, complete to Gary Eng. Eng breaks one tackle. First down, breaks another tackle. He's got a receiver. Eng could go all the way, cuts it back in, and Eng dragged down at the 12-yard line. Finally, by Ernie Spears. They saved the touchdown. Chula Vista all the way down to the 11.
Well, that's just a lot of missed tackles and a good individual effort by that young man. And that's going to help this offense quite a bit if they can get the ball to somebody else other than Darnell Woods. They've thrown the ball, they've only caught about 60 passes this year, and 40 of them went to Woods. that's how they try. They get the ball as much as possible. As we see a flag on the play before the play even started. Might be a, we'll wait and see what the call is.
Illegal procedure. Somebody lined up offside for Chula Vista. That'll make it first and 15. Chula Vista beat Point Loma 13-0 in the opener of the playoffs and then beat San Pasquale 14-7 last week.
Herb Meyer doesn't look like a real happy man right now, if I were just to go for a snap judgment there.
Pudgall going to the air again, puts it up looking for Woods. The pass incomplete. Ernie Spears in on the coverage.
Spears also had a lot of help, and that's what they're going to have to do against Woods, because this is what Chula Vista wants to do. They're going to try to get Woods into different areas, line him up from a wide receiver position, but line him up at tight end, and try to get him the football, because he's the man they want to go to. Had a big game last week, and he was really seemed to be the difference in that two-way game. Had a couple of touchdowns, had passes, a couple of interceptions to his credit.
Let's take a look at the offensive line for Chula Vista while we have a moment. Right there we've got Fuentes, Barbie, Butterfield, Harris, Patlin.
Some pretty guys,
guys
there.
Are big. They average 218 across, with Fuentes the biggest at 240. A definite advantage for Chula Vista. They've been opening quite a few holes all year long.
Chula Vista did not get a lot of credit coming into the season, but they played very, very well all season long, and they do not have a definitive weakness. We take a look at the receivers, looking at number 88 in particular here. He's been the big man all season long, but we've already seen that Aang can do a good job, number 20, and Rodney Reams caught a few passes too, and he's only a junior. Rodney Dean, they're going to be doing a lot this year with those receivers. And they've got a couple of good running backs, too. Even with Fredo Dwyer hurt, they can still hurt you with the running game. Not a team with a weakness that you can that shows up on paper.
Second down and 15 for the Spartans. Play action pass, Pudgall sends it off to Pocklington, and Pocklington stopped well short of the goal line.
Tim Bush there to drag him down from behind. Good coverage by Bush to snap outside. See, Pocklington was all-league, just one of the many all-league selections on this Chula Vista team. And let's finish off the starting offensive lineup of Chula Vista with their starting backfield. Smile, guys. Everybody wants to look tough for these pictures. You see number 31 is Pocklington, 33 is Dwyer, 9, of course, is the quarterback, Darren Pudgill. Guys don't want to smile for those shots. I don't understand why. They think they got to look tough for the other team, but the other team's not watching anyways.
Third down and 11. Butlet looks over the middle. Darnell Woods was there. Penalty flags go down. We may have a pass interference.
Aang was hit coming across the middle by Miro. I don't believe he was the intended receiver, but he was close enough to the ball that we are going to have a penalty against El Camino for interference. And that hurts. And that's been hurting El Camino all season long, the penalties. Interesting enough, already 47 yards passing for Chula Vista today. With a 5:09 remaining in the first quarter there, they've shown what they want to do.
The ball now spotted at the 6-yard line. First down and goal. They give it up the middle to Pocklington. Pocklington fights his way inside the 5 to about the 4.
Coming off the bottom of the pile there, Casey Malulu. And it's going to be tough to run against the interior of this El Camino line. They're not necessarily very big. They don't have a person on the team over 6 foot. They got Malulu, who's probably the biggest kid, and he's about 205. But they're a good fly-around 3-4 defense, and it's going to be very difficult to run against them, especially in this type of situation.
And what they do best is take advantages of other teams' mistakes. Fredo Dwyer now in at halfback. And they give it to Pocklington, right side touchdown, but hold everything. Penalty flags are down. It will go against Chula Vista. It will not be a touchdown. Illegal motion.
Well, Herb, that should make you smile. Nope, Herb doesn't smile about those type of things. Herb doesn't smile until the day after the game. You'll see a lot of shots on the sidelines here of head coach of El Camino, Herb Meyer. And I don't think you're going to see him smile once. That's an official prediction. I won't say who's going to win the game, but I think I can predict safely that Herb Meyer won't smile.
Second down. Timeout called. The ball, 2nd and 9. Chula Vista at the El Camino 9-yard line.
See some of the assistant coaches here for El Camino. He has many of his ex-players on the sidelines with him. Matter of fact, the majority of his coaching staff, that is Herb Meyer's coaching staff, is comprised of ex-players. And that shows the respect the players have for him and the respect he has for his players.
You stick around for 25 years, you got a lot of guys to choose from.
This is true. I must say, I've been busy all week. I went to the Jerry Coleman School of pronouncing Samoan and Mexican names, and I am ready today. We have, between Sweetwater and El Camino, and we have some of the toughest names you could possibly toss at announcers.
Oh, come on, Teatafa, Malulu, easy money.
And of course, I failed the course, but you look like you ripped through it there. I'll let you take those names.
Therese Tuanua, who we'll see next game. Chula Vista back in action, 2nd down and 9. Man in motion. Hugo looks to the end zone, looking for Wood. It's going to be an interference call against Ernie Spears, and there's not much question about that.
And that was a very, very well-designed play. Let's give the coaching staff credit for that one. Woods lined up at a tight end situation. I was watching him the entire play. They ran motion away from him, made him the weak side, put a running back into the zone over there, so Woods had one-on-one coverage, and if there was an interference, Woods was going to come down with that ball. You just
knew question
it.
About it. He's 6'3", Spears 5'11". He had the advantage, and he's a fantastic tight end.
And two interference
penalties. You can't blame Spears for the penalty.
And now we've had two interference penalties within the 10-yard line now, and so Chula Vista is going to get 4 more shots at it. Please.
Up the middle, nothing doing there. Pocklington on the carry.
Jim Hankey was there that time on the defense for El Camino, along with Malulu once again. His linebackers for El Camino play very, very tough, and they're very, very active. It's going to be 2nd down and 5 for Chula Vista. And another tough 5 yards. Really got the feeling they're going to have to go to the air for it.
And Pudgall takes it all the way himself. Quarterback sneak. Pudgall goes the distance. A good call right there. El Camino certainly surprised by that. Pudgall picks up the 5 yards.
Well, obviously they saw something. They saw that the center was not being covered. And that is an excellent call if it's going to be open.
And now we're going to get to see Gary Ng, who is the kicker for Chula Vista, number 20. He warms up before the game. He kicks either way and decides which way he wants to kick. And we'll see him kicking right-footed tonight, but he goes either way. And Ng's kick is up, and it is good. Chula Vista takes a 7-0 lead.
Big drive for Chula Vista. The big play, of course, the pass completion to Ng. Take a look at the touchdown, I believe. There's nobody over the replay of the fans. There we go. That was good. Okay. That's the end result. Ng going over from the 4-yard line on the quarterback draw. And it puts the Spartans up 7-0 after a kick by Ng, but it was Ng's big pass completion, a 43-yard run up the middle on a quick out pattern that set up that touchdown and puts the Spartans one step closer to a 2A championship.
Chula Vista's 11-1 on the year, but they have not been blowing anybody out all season long. They did have 2 major victories, 49-0 over Coronado being one of them, but what they do is they capitalize on other teams' mistakes. Last week against San Pasqual ran up and down the field but could only get one touchdown. Chula Vista capitalized on a fumble by San Pasqual deep in San Pasqual territory, took it in for the winning touchdown. They've been doing it all year long.
The only game they lost, as we mentioned, was the Sweetwater. They only lost that game 20-14. Sweetwater has been number 1 all season long, at least in the polls. and in the hearts of Sweetwater fans, of course. But that's a pretty impressive to go outing against a 3A team of such power.
And in that one loss, the decisive touchdown was scored when Sweetwater intercepted a pass and went all the way. As we see the kick, it'll take a couple of bounces. And it's picked up at the 30 by Gene Hughes.
Fumble's going to go to Chula Vista.
Chula Vista's got it. Chula Vista is in the driver's seat here. Gene Hughes picked it up after it dropped it, picked it up again, got hit, lost it for good.
Bart Leonhardt, the man who's going to get credited with recovering that fumble, and that's one more big break in the Spartans' favor. That's what you try to do when you squib kick it like that, cause some confusion. Hughes wanted to pitch it back, didn't have time, and instead went running into the line straight up and took a couple of good hits.
That's what Chula Vista's done all year. Capitalize on mistakes. Now they have a first down at the 34-yard line. Pudgall from the shotgun, looking across the middle, complete at the 20-yard line to Deed. Deed fumbles it, and El Camino gets it back.
Let's wait and see what the call is, if it's a reception or not.
I think the officials are going to count it dead. Indeed, that is the case. They will call it dead before the fumble.
They're going to call it a reception and then dead. As you see, they say the ball squirted out after he hit the ground. On the play for El Camino, and that could have been a big turnaround.
It'll be a first down and 10 for Chula
Vista. I assume that wasn't a Spartan, so I think it's a Wildcat.
I believe you're right.
Okay.
First and 10. Sweep to Pocklington. Pocklington doesn't get anything there. Coming in to make the stop is Bush for El Camino, and it'll be second down and 10.
Number 54, Tim Bush.
Well, it's the first time they've run on first down. You've got a feeling that they should try to run just to at least try to keep them honest. That is the Wildcats. But it's real obvious coming into this game is Chula Vista wants to throw the ball.
Second down and 10. Woods in motion. And that's where they're looking for. Woods wide open and is stopped at the 3-yard line. A good tackle by Ernie Spears coming over, but Woods was wide open. Looked like he was going to go all the way.
El Camino is going to have to play some very heads-up defense here because they know they want to key on Darnell Woods, but they can't. They don't know where Woods is coming from. That time, as you said, they lined him up at a flanker, sent him in motion to the other side, and they had no chance to cover him or give him any special coverage, and Woods was wide open.
First down and goal at the 4-yard line. They give it to Pocklington. Pocklington perhaps gets halfway there to the 2.
Let's take a look at what Woods does on this reception. The prior play, Pudgill puts the ball out there. Woods goes in motion. Pudgill just looks at him right away, and nobody got over there in time, and Woods was wide open. He drops the ball afterwards too, but after the play was dead, sets up this situation at second down and 3.
Pocklington and Krim in the backfield. It'll be Pocklington hit immediately, and Pocklington's not going anywhere.
Well, with 1:07 remaining in the first quarter, Pocklington already has his share of bruises. He's finding the going awfully tough in the interior of that El Camino line. And this will bring up a big third down and 3 situation. You got to believe that they're going to have to go to the air. I said this last time they quarterback drawed and got a touchdown out of it, but in a third down situation, let's look at where Woods lines up. You see him on the tight end to his right there.
Pudgall looking for his 10th touchdown through the air. He's in trouble. And now Pudgall goes down. Big play for El Camino.
Very, very big play. Jim Hankey was in there, and they just put a lot of good pressure. Did not let Pudgill get outside. As we see the intensity of the rush put on Pudgill on the replay, they come after him. They're trying to get one of those little people off the line of scrimmage. He had Dean in the corner of the end zone. Pudgill just never had a chance.
That'll be the end of the first quarter with Chula Vista on top, 7-0.
It'll be Ng lining up for a 33-yard kick. We take it down to Don Tennyson down on the sidelines.
Obviously, there's not a lot to talk about as far as the El Camino Wildcats are concerned, because Coach Herb Meyer and his staff are not real happy with the way things have gone. Kevin, you were exactly right when you talked about the smiles on the sidelines here as far as El Camino is concerned, because the entire coaching staff is extremely upset with the way that their team has played. By his own admission, Coach Meyer had a quote in the paper earlier this week that said, our team has been mistake prone throughout the entire season. So this really should not be a surprise, the way that the Wildcats have played here in the first quarter. Both clubs a little shaky early. Let's go back upstairs.
All righty, thank you very much, Don. And now we'll see Egg on a 34-yard field goal attempt.
34-yard attempt.
And the kick is up. It's good. Chula Vista takes a 10-0 lead. They got the cannon fired up again. I don't know if the cannon's playing favorites tonight, but so far it's only been shooting for Chula Vista. They get a 10-0 lead with one play gone in the second quarter. It's been all Chula Vista. And as Don mentioned, it's been the mistakes. And it's been that problem all season long for El Camino, the penalties especially. And that one turnover now, the fumble by Hughes. And it puts these Wildcats in your picture in a very big hole.
Chula Vista, 79 yards passing.
And rushing minus 4 yards. So I think it's an indication of what they want to do and what they're going to be able to do. Pug goes 4 of 8 so far on his evening, but it's been the big plays.
He's thrown 10 interceptions this year, however, none in the playoffs. Completed 91 of 170 passes on the year and 9 touchdowns.
And I guess the bottom line is here, those who don't know anything about Chula Vista, who never heard of them, let's point out they are a good team. They played good all season long. They played well all season long, and they deserve to be here, and they're proving it.
Another squib to kick picked up. Now El Camino's just going to fall on it. They're not going to take a chance of a fumble. They'll take over at the 27-yard line.
And at that point, that's a good play. Once it starts bouncing around down there, don't take any chances. You want the football. Let's see what this El Camino offense can put together now. They really need to establish what they want to do and put together a drive if they can. Norris has not had any type of established game so far. No big runs.
It'll be Norris. Left side looking for hole. He's got the outside. And Norris knocked out of bounds by number 80, Scott Falls of Chula Vista. But he picks up a big gain. And it'll be a first down.
We stress the importance of Darren Norris, but of course he was gone for 4 games of El Camino season and they won without him. But in a game like this, he's going to be the man. If they're behind by 10 points as they are, he's the big play man. He's had some very big games. He's rushed for over 177 yards in one game, 153 yards against Crawford last week, and 168 yards against Helix. So he can dominate a game by himself.
Norris in motion. It'll go to Norris. Norris catches it, fakes out one guy, comes across and gets up near the 50-yard line before Falls tackles him, along with Keith Krim, number 40.
So Herb Meyer is going to say, fine, let's get the young man the football. We don't necessarily have to hand it to him. Let's try to isolate him to the outside. Let's put him one-on-one on a defensive back. That's good philosophy, and it's working for him right now.
It'll be second down and 2. Good move by Norris. Allowed him to pick up that 8-yard gain. They give it to Miro up the middle. Miro breaks a couple of tackles, gets into Chula Vista territory at the 43-yard line.
Matt Esposito on the carry. That's a little bit of a surprise. He's usually in a running back position. Look on the sideline. Miro's not hurt, and in fact, I think he's going to go back in the ball game as he is right now, along with Scott Thurman, the split end. But they get the first down. Wildcats coming back.
The ball at the 43-yard line for the Wildcats. Johnson gives it to Miro this time. Left side, Miro bulls his way down to the 35.
Okay. Miro was the Avocado League Defensive Player of the Year, but he goes both ways. He's just a good athlete. He's not the type of person that
the pro scouts are going to be after, because he's not real big. He's 5'6", 165, but he's just a good, solid football player. And he'll help Norris get free by making him play that fullback honest.
Mike Uhlender splits to the right, Thurmond to the left. Second and short, fake to Norris. Johnson wants the throw, puts it up. Looking for Uhlender, it's not going to count if he catches it. He does at the 7-yard line. The official is not going to get it, but he went out of bounds and came back in to get that. That is an illegal play.
You can go out of bounds and come back into the field, but you cannot come back, I believe, to catch the ball in one motion. You have to reestablish yourself, or if you were hit out of bounds, I believe you can come back in. I know there are some things that may make
it illegal. Let's take another look at it. Quickly, watch how he's out of bounds, and then we'll come back in. We really couldn't see it right there, but he was out of bounds and then came back in. Now back to live action, Norris up the middle and down to the 4-yard line.
I think you might be right. I'm not real sure what the rule is there, but either way, that was a great catch by Demery, and let's not minimize that because he went up for the ball. He kicked the ball away from the defender.
Good point, Kevin. Scott Thurmond brings the play in. Second down and goal from the 5-4 El Camino. Miro at fullback. Norris at tailback. And Johnson on the option, keeps it himself and perhaps gains a yard, but that's about it. And it'll be third and goal from about the 4.
This is going to be an interesting call for Herb Meyer's staff. Johnson, I think what they like to do is give Johnson some options. Look, we're on the scoreboard. Southwestern Cable makes the big time, the Jack Murphy scoreboard. Big play here, 3rd and 4. I think they're gonna try to give Johnson some options. Let's see what they do.
He pitches it out to Norris. Norris is gonna go for the corner and score a touchdown for the El Camino Wildcats. The cannon no longer showing any favoritism as Norris strolls in from 4 yards out. He saw the flag and went for it.
He strolled in because of a fantastic block up front by Steve Miro. They ran the option. They gave Darren Norris a lead block. Miro made the block, and he was gone. Once you give him that first step, he'll beat everybody to the sidelines.
Miro now will kick the extra pointer, will attempt it. Matt Esposito on the hold. Miro's kick is up, and it is good. El Camino now on the scoreboard, trails by just 3, 10-7.
Really good drive for the Wildcats. Exactly what they wanted. Let's take a look at the touchdown. Look at the block out front by number 5, Steve Miro. Straight option. Miro just crushes that defensive block, and that's all Darren Norris needs. We've got the CIF sprint champion. You give him a block like that, and all he needs is 4 yards to the corner of the end zone. He's gone. And that's a great drive for the Wildcats. So exactly when they needed it, they were down by 10 points. They put together a big drive. And they got the ball to the man they wanted to get it to, Darren Norris. Big play by Demery on a pass by Johnson. And that gets them 7 points. We got ourselves a football game.
Critical that they were able to reestablish momentum as it looked like Chula Vista might even run away with this thing. Short kick, it'll be taken at the 18-yard line. No, Andy Nozak on the carry. Check that, it's Pocklington, number 31.
We should bring up something we really haven't talked about yet also, and that's that it's so nice to be back here at San Diego Stadium. Let's give credit to the San Diego CIF, the San Diego City Council. Darren Norris is a happy man. He's glad to be back here at the stadium. But they really put it together last year. They were not here. And this year they went to the City Council, and all the people who wrote letters, it's worth it because they're back here at the stadium. The kids are happy to be here, and we're happy to be here.
Certainly you have to thank WTBS and San Diego State as we see Crib hit immediately right there. Stopped for no gain.
Tim Bush there along with Steve Luna. It took a lot of factors to get this game and the 3A game back at the stadium. And we don't want to slight anybody by starting to name too many names. So we'll just thank everybody who made the effort because it's definitely worth it.
I think it was interesting. After Herb Meyer realized his team was going to make it in the stadium, despite so many odds that faced them at the beginning of the year, he thought about last year's team, which did not have the opportunity to play in the stadium. Co-champions nonetheless. as we see Pudgall complete the pass to Egg. Egg finds the outside and gets all the way down to the 41-yard line of El Camino.
Great job once again by Eng. He gets the ball out there, makes a move, and gets some extra yardage. That's the second time he's been able to do that, and it's a second big play for him. This is a quick out pattern to Eng. He catches the ball. He's just got one-on-one coverage out there, catches it, turns around, and makes a move. It gets by the defender.
Cyril Ontai just pulling him down. First and 10 at the 41. Pudgall puts it up, completes it to Rodney Dean. Over the middle, it'll be near a first down.
Ernest Spears on the coverage there. Pudgall's really hot right now. He's on the mark. He's picking the right receiver and drilling the ball to him. And the El Camino defense is starting to concentrate a little bit more on Darnell Woods. You can see it when you follow him just a little bit, and that's going to open up things for Dean and Eng as we have a measurement on the first down play. But they're using a lot of versatility now from that passing game, and Pudgill's picking out the right receivers, and that's going to make them very, very tough this evening.
Just inches away from a first down for Chula Vista. 6:38 remaining in the first half. Chula Vista on top, 10-7. Second and inches.
Sometimes called a throwaway down. Sometimes you like to go for the big play here.
Pudgall looking to throw, puts it up. Looking for Egg. Egg, did he stay in bounds? No, he did not. And the official immediately calling it incomplete. I almost got the impression that he was calling it before the pass was completed, that he might have gone out of bounds.
Well, that was a big play that time because they tried to be a little tricky. They ran Eng on a little out pattern, then they ran him up the field trying to play games on Darren Norris, the quarterback, who was not fooled that time. It was good coverage, and Eng almost made a great catch. Eng already has 3 receptions for 92 yards, but not that time.
Third down in inches. Wood goes in motion. Pudgall keeps it and gets the first down handily.
Quarterback keeper by number 9, Darren.
That's going to help their confidence, too. When you know that you can get that third and short, then you can go ahead and try some fancy things on second down and short and try to loosen things up a little bit. With 6:13 now remaining in the first half, if you just joined us, the Chula Vista Spartans lead 10-7. 2A championship game. We, of course, will also be covering the 3A championship game facing off Sweetwater against Mira Mesa. Just part of Southwestern's continuing commitment to community television.
First and 10 from the 30-yard line.
It's in my contract.
And we'll have play stop there. It appears somebody lined up offside. No, delay of game called against Chula Vista.
We don't want that. This is they've been doing a good job of playing penalty-free football, driving down the field, and now all of a sudden they're faced with a first and 15. Mental mistakes will be the difference in this ball game, without a doubt. It's already become very, very evident.
Abe Perez splits to the left. Pudgall with 4 receivers downfield, looks across the middle. Incomplete, pass intended for Pocklington.
Pudgill's now 6 of 11 for 108 yards. And he's going to be in a second down and 15 situation. Good coverage that time by El Camino. El Camino is starting playing good pass defense. Look down the field, Pocklington was going down the middle. He had Woods to the outside, and Pudgill just tried to throw it to an open zone, and Pocklington couldn't get to it.
Second down, 15 yards to go for Chula Vista. From the shotgun, Pudgill takes the high snap, throws across the middle, and nicely broken up by Spears of El Camino. Spears, an outstanding athlete, was the quarterback last year for El Camino, which took him all the way to the semifinals, but Johnson played so well that it wasn't that Myers didn't think he could go without Spears, didn't think that Spears couldn't handle a quarterback, but Spears can help his team so much in the defensive backfield.
And Spears did a good job that time. He had Woods one-on-one, and he did the job. And that is a tough job going up against one of the best receivers in the county.
Third down at 15 for the Spartans. Hudgel from the shotgun puts it up, looking for Egg, and Egg was able to break loose. The pass not there, and it'll be fourth down at 15 for Chula Vista.
Good job that time putting pressure on Pudgill. He did not have a chance really to set up and throw the ball. He had to throw it off his back foot. And El Camino stopped him. Big series. See, warming up on the sidelines there is Demery playing catch with Johnson. They're just trying to stay warm because it is a chilly night out here.
Miro drops back to receive the punt from Pocklington. Fourth and 15. Chula Vista, a long snap count right there, perhaps hoping El Camino is going to go offside.
Why? They have 15 yards to go. They're taking their time. I don't know why.
And now they're probably just waiting for a delay of game. They'll wait for the penalty. No, a high snap there. Pocklington's kick is partially blocked. And now taken. Matt Newton on the block. And gets El Camino to take over at the 26-yard line. Number 31, who does not show up on our roster, was the one who made the catch.
Our first mystery man. It wouldn't be high school football if we didn't know, have one player we couldn't identify. Block didn't do him a whole lot of good there, but it was still nice. Mike Newton got a big thrill out of it.
Without the block, they may have been in deep in their own territory. The give is to Miro. Miro will pick up a couple, but that's about all. So if it had gone into the end zone, they would have gone into the 20. And from that distance, it's very likely that they might have gone inside the 20, so it certainly didn't hurt him, and it helped him somewhat.
There's Newton. He got a big thrill out of it. I agree. It was a good job blocking that punt. I'm not trying to not to knock that.
And
it's not usually a block punt that you would think decided the game, maybe set up a big play or something. This wasn't one of those pivotal type of block punts, is what I'm trying to say here.
Another penalty. It looks like a Chula Vista player had lined up offsides. Indeed, that is the call. And kind of a penalty you wouldn't expect to see after 12 games here at the CIF Championship. Nonetheless, it'll be second down and 3 for El Camino after the penalty. Miro, the lone running back. Johnson going to the air, broken up nicely by number 15 of Chula Vista, Luis Peraza.
Well, it's just the timing pattern, trying to get that receiver between the linebacker and the defensive back. But Peraza did a good job, came up to the ball very, very well, and it'll bring up a third down and 3 situation for the Wildcats.
It's one of the Wildcat cheerleaders. Ullinger lines up wide to the right. They're going to give it to Norris and let him make it. Norris does get the first down and more up near the 41-yard line.
That illustrates the power of a Darren Norris. He's such a fast young kid. He's the sprint champion. We mentioned that. But look what he does on this play. He goes up the middle and he breaks tackles. He's not afraid to go inside. People trying to tackle him around his legs there just are not going to have any luck. He cannot arm tackle Darren Norris.
In addition to that, he was going to the short side of the field and knew when to cut up. First and 10. Norris left side, got a big hole, winds up in the middle and runs into one of his own men, or he might have gone further, stopped at the 48-yard line of El Camino.
Good kick out block by Matt Esposito. Good play that time by that offensive line of the Wildcats. Downfield blocking was Malulu. Good execution by the Wildcats now. If they can stay penalty free, they're moving the ball very well. Their fans are happy about it too.
Second down and 3. Johnson looks downfield, completes it to Demery, and Demery driven out of bounds at the 41-yard line. It'll be another El Camino first down.
Demery, just another one of the juniors on this Wildcat team. This team, most of the people, if you see Demery go into his pattern on the replay, just good execution, just a good little out pattern by Johnson. Looking at Demery the entire way, This team, most of these juniors, played together on a freshman team that went undefeated, and they were good enough. They played the junior varsity, and they beat the junior varsity as a freshman team. And most of these, that's why most of these juniors here are used to winning.
First down and 10 for the Wildcats. Johnson rolls right, trying to keep it out, puts it up, and just throws it away. A good play right there. He had Bart Leonhardt and Jorge Ibarra coming right after him, hoping to greet him, and he just tossed it out of bounds.
And that's the type of play that shows the maturity of Ken Johnson and shows how he has improved. Beginning a season, he might not have done that. He might have tried to force it. Now he's learning how to throw it away and learning how sometimes you've got to do some extra things. And sometimes it's okay to eat a few yards.
Vidal splits far to the right. They give it to Norris. Norris trying to find some room outside, gets outside, and then cuts it back up and gets to the 37-yard line, perhaps the 38. He's really an outstanding back, takes a play right there that looked like it was destined to perhaps lose yardage for a very small gain, and turns it into a 6-yard gain.
What was interesting was last year they had him play fullback with Leroy Lafitte, the big man at tailback. Lafitte, who went on to play some great football last year, was a great workhorse back. Now Norris is playing his natural tailback position and is having a good time.
Third down for El Camino. They give it up the middle. And short of the first down is Norris to the 35. It'll be fourth and 3.
And it'll be decision time, and as you hear him in the background, they're going to punt it.
They're going to bring the punting team out.
Band is already out, ready to go, just in case they want to go for an early halftime play. Bring in the band. No, we'll wait. We'll punt it first.
On the side, good luck to the Sweetwater Red Devils from the Chula Vista Spartans. Those southern teams, I guess, sticking together. We'll see Sweetwater up next against Mira Mesa. And it is a fake. And falling down is Demery. He had a chance to get the first down, but he fell.
Well, whether he had a chance for the first down was debatable. David Lilly was giving him good pressure, and Peraza was right there. Let's take a look at it and see exactly what kind of chance he had. He brings the ball down, and immediately, he's got a lot of people in front of him right there. Falling on him was Steve Garski. Either way, it's Chula Vista ball, first and 10.
Not a bad call as Chula Vista at the 39-yard line. Oh, their own 39-yard line, certainly not in tremendous position. Late in the half, I like that call by Meyer. Gutsy. Pass complete to Dean. Dean to the 48-yard line of El Camino.
Well, and before you join the Herb Meyer fan club, I agree it was a good call, but I agree it was a good call because it wasn't gutsy, because he had nothing to lose by going for it. But once again, Chula Vista's passing game is being very, very efficient. Once again, we look at Pudgill, goes back, and very efficient. Three-step drop, hits his receiver right in the open zone, and they get a big gain out of it.
And a big hit by Bush. Pudgill gives it to the second man through. Nothing there.
Time winding down in the first half now. They have to start playing the clock a little bit. 1:13 remaining in the first half. One advantage of a passing team is you do not have to go out of your offense as much when you go into your two-minute drill.
Chula Vista has not stopped the clock. Less than 52 seconds left now, and the snap goes up high. Pudgill now trying to get it. He does, and then is tackled immediately back at the 29-yard line. The snap over his head. Good defensive play by number 64, Casey Malaulu.
And I give Pudgill a 3-5 on his flip after being tackled. Good pressure. We look at the snap, goes over his head on the replay. Pudgill has never had a chance at it. And now he's just trying to get away. Now look at his, maybe we won't see it afterwards, but okay. Nice little flip after he got tackled. Clock stopped with 39 seconds to go in the first half.
Malulu just kicking back with one of his buddies right there, number 64. Taking a breather. Third down, 20 to go.
Malulu and Norris are the only returning starters for the Wildcat team off the team that last year tied Point Loma 6-6. But there are a lot of players who were on that team And it's given them a little extra incentive because they had a bitter taste in their mouths after that game last year. They really felt they wanted to play another quarter. They wanted to play for a championship.
That was one of the worst games they played all year long.
They were a dominating team last year. This year they've had their problems, their ups and downs, even though they've won eight of their last nine games. They felt last year's team was going to be the dominating team.
Or next year's, when they've got some of these youngsters. They're a year early from what they expected, but this team has really gelled, and that's such a cliche term, but this team really has grown together. The give to Pocklington. He'll pick up a short yard or two. Now El Camino will call another timeout, stop the clock with 35 seconds left. The Wildcats hoping to perhaps block the punt or get a good run back and get into position for a play or two to get them down into field goal position.
Well, they'll have time, 35 seconds remain on the clock, and they should have excellent field position. Miro lining up at his own 35-yard line. I think he's got a lot of faith in the leg of Pocklington. And the El Camino Wildcats are in a huddle. They might be trying to block it.
I suspect that they will be going for it rather than setting up the return.
Well, usually you don't send two men back when you're going after a block, but let's see. They appear to be going after it. They're coming.
Not this time, and we have a player running to the kicker, but there'll be no penalty. Esposito takes it to the 42 and is stopped right there. Good acting job by Pocklington after he had Mike Vidal had just kind of slid into him. No Academy Awards tonight.
I was going to say that. They don't give you a penalty for acting because Pocklington was maybe just grazed on the way, and even then he was even blocked. Vidal was blocked into him. But it'll be first and 10 for the Wildcats from their own 42-yard line.
They call Pocklington the fall guy. Johnson looking to pass under some pressure, and he's not going to get anything off there as Eric Collinson comes in and takes him down.
And Johnson's still on the ground.
The clock will wind down. El Camino no longer, and in fact, now El Camino will stop the clock. Just 4 seconds left as we'll take another shot at Collinson coming in there virtually unmolested.
And he threw Johnson down very, very hard. Johnson very slow getting up, and as you see, he seems to be shaken up. Now this is, we had talked about Ernie Spears beforehand, the advantage of having a quarterback that has seen, a backup quarterback who has seen some action.
And
we hope, Ken Johnson will be back, however.
They allow the clock to run out, and that ends it at halftime with Chula Vista on top of the CIF 2A championship game here at San Diego Jack Murphy Stadium, the Spartans 10, El Camino 7.
It's been a very interesting first half for the Spartans in that they were able to pass the ball, and they were able to pass the ball effectively, but not necessarily to Darnell Woods. Eng had a very efficient first half. Eng was really the big play man for him, and they also were able to get the ball to Rodney Dean, and that's the diversity they need from that passing game. And if they're able to get that type of efficiency, the Spartans are going to be very tough in the second.